not about, it's not about, it's not about the injury. It's not about, it's not about, it's not about the injury. It's about the recovery. It's about the recovery.
Hello, this is Tony Abitangelo. Live, and I always say live because I'm used to doing the live, but pre-recorded at the Red Gym Studios for the Paul Pata podcast. And I'm happy to say I got my friend Dan Gilliam here.
Hi, Tony.
How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good to have you on board today.
Thank you for having me, I appreciate it.
And we got you on the case on the podcast today talking about DUI defense and prosecution, just depending on what angle you look at it. But before we jump into that, why don't we get a little bit about your background, and aren't you running for district court, Judge?
I am, yeah. So I guess I'll start with a background issue. I got my undergrad and graduate degrees in education. I thought I wanted to be a teacher. About halfway through graduate school, I realized I did not want to, but I'd already put the time and the money into it, so I might as well get the degree.
Makes sense.
I then worked for about 4 years at a residential treatment facility for foster kids. I was on the line for 2 years. I was program director for 2 years after that, and then went to law school after that.
So you ended up here in Vegas, mm-hmm. and where'd you start working?
I started working at the Clark County Public Defender's Office. I did that for about 2.5 years, representing everyone charged with minor misdemeanors all the way up to major felonies. And then I worked at the City of Henderson as a prosecutor for almost 8 years, prosecuting mainly DUIs and domestic violence charges. And then at the beginning of 2015, I opened up my own practice. And then about 3 years after that, my practice was taken over by Bighorn Law, which is where I work now. I handle all of their criminal work.
All right, so you have a lot of background in DUIs.
I do, yeah. I've defended and prosecuted, I would have to say, thousands of them.
Especially prosecuting, because you were doing that for so many years. That's
exactly
where we first met.
Exactly right.
Okay, so let's get into the DUI world, because a lot of people drink. They make the poor decision to drive. They get pulled over.
It happens.
I think that's something that happens more commonly in people experience the judicial system through a DUI than, the felony type cases.
Of course, of course.
So what's a reason to stop somebody? What's a probable cause purpose?
All right, so the officer is going to be looking not necessarily for anyone that's driving drunk per se, but they're going to be looking for any kind of traffic violations. And typically those that are under the influence of alcohol or another controlled substance are going to have more difficulty controlling their vehicle than someone that's sober. And so a lot of things they'll do is either they'll drive too slowly, or they will speed, or they will swerve within their lane, or they'll make lane change without signaling. Any kind of traffic infraction that the officer sees, the officer's going to pull you over and kind of find out what's going on.
So once again, just any traffic stop. Mm-hmm. Once again, running a red light,
exactly.
Running a stop sign, any normal traffic violation gets you pulled over.
Or abnormal things like falling asleep at the Taco Bell drive-thru. It's one of my favorites, by the way.
That's amazing. How many people have you either represented or prosecuted where they're at the red light? Mm-hmm. Forget the Taco Bell.
Mm-hmm.
And their foot's on the brake, and mm-hmm. the light goes red, green, red, green.
More than you would expect. Yes.
It's amazing. And their foot doesn't slip off the brake.
That's true.
How does that happen? it's just like, and then,
yep.
I would say that's probable cause.
I would say that as well.
That's probable cause.
The officer has a good reason to pull you over at that point.
Yeah, or at least investigate what's going on. So you get the probable cause. They could be, like you said, variety of reasons, but your normal traffic violations.
Yes.
However, certain types of stops indicate more of a impairment.
Yeah, I think
such
the
as the swerving.
Yeah, the officer's going to be on alert if you are swerving within your lane. That's for sure going to be a cue to the officer.
So when my last client, who's in the middle lane of three, hits the goes all the way over to the shoulder of the road, mm-hmm. bounces back to the other side, mm-hmm. and then just goes like 30 miles an hour to 45 zone.
Yeah, they're going to be alert, and they're going to wonder, okay, it looks like more than just a traffic stop.
Right. Mm-hmm. All right. So then what happens next once you get stopped? What does an individual, what advice can we give to a driver that they have to lawfully comply with?
So this would go for anybody being pulled over, including a DUI investigation.
Correct.
The officer is going to, most times, officers are going to be polite, and they are going to ask you questions like, can I see your driver's license and registration and proof of insurance, please? My standard advice is, if an officer asks you a question, you have the ability to answer in the negative if you like. If the officer...
So, hey, Mr. Gilliam, give me your driver's license, insurance, registration, and you say no.
That's not a request. You said, give me your. That's an order.
See, that's what we do.
Yes.
We pick on the words.
Right.
So, do you have a driver's license?
Yes. I would answer yes to that, and he says, I need to see it. Here you go, because that's an order.
That's an order.
Mm-hmm.
Because what happens when you don't give them, when you don't comply with the orders?
Yeah, so it is a law that you must, you know, comply with an officer's lawful order, and one of those things is you must identify yourself to an officer if he or she asks.
And that's been upheld at the United States Supreme
Court.
It
has, yes.
All right, so officer pulls over, the individual driving, insurance registration, mm-hmm. driver's license, you turn it over.
Mm-hmm.
What goes on next?
Now, the officer's doing a couple of things while you're doing that. The officer
yeah.
is watching you to see kind of how you respond to his or her questions and also how well you can comport with their request. And so the officer is going to be not just waiting for you to give him those documents. The officer is going to be, you know, smelling to see if you emit any kind of odor from your breath that would suggest you've been drinking alcohol. They are going to be seeing if you're slurring your words, if you have trouble finding the documents. They're taking mental notes of all of these things as you are doing what you're told.
The classic... I tell all my people that come in on DUIs is the unknown odor of alcoholic beverage, mm-hmm. bloodshot, watery eyes,
mm-hmm. slurred speech,
mm-hmm. and fumbled for their documents.
Mm-hmm. Those are all pretty standard things that an officer will put in his or her report to kind of support the fact that they are going to start with their DUI investigation.
Where are the police being taught this information?
So they get that at the academy. The academy will offer them all the things that they need to know for DUI. And actually, when I was a prosecutor in Henderson, I helped out with some of the training for DUIs with the officers that were in training for that at the police academy.
So the training you gave to officers, excuse me, was after they already graduated the academy and they're full-fledged officers?
No, it was during the academy.
Oh,
we would do it
during
the academy.
Mm-hmm. So you're the guy I got to blame for this.
I can be one of them, sure.
Because every report says the same thing, right?
It does, yes, they're pretty consistent.
But then again, that's also the standard signs of somebody who's been drinking.
Exactly right.
I mean, for anybody listening and watching, if you or your friends have been drinking, you smell of alcohol.
Do you have bloodshot, watery eyes? All those things are going to be pretty visible.
Yeah, so it's not like you're teaching a secret.
No, not at all.
But you're teaching them how to write the reports.
One, obviously, if they do not witness those things, they should not put them in the report, but yes.
Correct. All right, so then they'll ask you to step out of the vehicle, correct?
They will. Now, they can ask you, but they can also order you to. There's also a rule that says you must exit a vehicle if an officer tells you to.
And expand upon that.
So a lot of people think that they don't have to get out of the car if the officer tells them to. I'm telling you now, you do have to get out. There is a Supreme Court rule that says if an officer orders you or a passenger out of the car, you must comply with that order.
So you jump out or walk out of the car.
Mm-hmm.
And... what happens next traditionally in a DUI stop?
So the officer is going to start his or her investigation with regards to are you under the influence of alcohol or some other kind of intoxicant. And so they are going to make the request for you to do some field sobriety tests. Before that, they may ask you several questions. They're going to ask you questions like, are you under the influence of any kind of controlled substance now? Do you take any medications from a doctor? Do you have any kind of seizure disorders? They're going to have a whole list of questions that they ask.
Where are you coming from?
Exactly right.
Where are you going?
How much have you had to drink? When did you have your last drink? When did you sleep last?
Do I have to answer those questions?
No, you don't have to answer those questions at all. If you say, I don't want to participate, you don't have to participate.
Because those are not orders.
Correct.
They're questions.
They're asking you to comply with their investigation.
I joke around with our clients, if you've got a bottle of Jack Daniels in your hand, a joint in your mouth, and a heroin needle in your arm, and they ask you if you've been doing drugs or alcohol, what's the answer?
Well,
no, right?
You can answer whatever you want to answer, but they're going to be able to figure things out pretty quickly.
You don't have to answer those questions.
No, you don't have to answer anything.
And there will not be any adverse consequences.
That's correct. That's correct.
I mean, I think we could all agree that might expedite you being arrested.
Well,
The other side, you don't lose your driving privileges or nothing like that. There's no adverse legal consequences.
I tell you what may be a consequence of it. So officers are going to note in their report whether you were cooperative. If they put uncooperative in there, and then they can expand on that in their narrative about how you just, you know, were not polite to the officers, you were a jerk to them, you were not complying with any of their orders, the prosecutor is going to read that and have less sympathy for you than he or she would if you were cooperative with the officers.
Right. So if you're going to do this, be polite.
Yes, of course. Be respectful.
Always be respectful.
Yes.
My dad was a lawyer. I grew up in the law. He defended people in criminal as well as civil cases. And that's what he said. Always be polite to the officers because they have the power mm-hmm. over you. And one of those things is to write the report.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, a prosecutor, and you being a former prosecutor.
That was always a red flag for me when I read a report, was that the person was uncooperative or in any way disrespectful to the officers. I was less likely to give that person a good negotiation because of that.
Right.
I'll be honest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's part of the rules of the road.
Mm-hmm.
So once again, we start the field sobriety test.
Mm-hmm.
Do I have to do the field sobriety test?
No, so the field sobriety test, you know, comprised typically of three different things. One is called the HGN, the horizontal gaze nystagmus, where they test your eyes. Exactly. That's right.
For
exactly
the people
right.
watching, the famous pen.
12 inches away from the face. They're going to look for several different things with your eyes in that situation. That's the first test. The next two are called divided attention tests. And what that means is the officer is going to give you a litany of rules to follow with regards to the upcoming test. And then you need to not only perform the test, but remember the directions as to how that went.
And traditionally what I'm seeing is, are two of them, a one-leg stand mm-hmm. and a walk and turn.
And a walk and turn, exactly right.
Explain what the one-leg stand is.
So the one-leg stand, the officer is looking for four different clues. He's going to have, he or she is going to have you stand on 1 foot and then count to about 30. One, two, three, four, per second is what they're going to try and gauge you at. And then they are going to look and see if you are swaying, if you're losing your balance, if you put your foot down, that kind of thing.
And then the walk and turn?
Walk and turn, they're going to be looking for 8 clues total. Those clues will include walking 9 steps in one direction in a heel-toe fashion, staying on a line, executing the turn properly as they had instructed you before to start the test, and then the 9 steps back.
Do I have to take the field sobriety test?
No.
Any adverse legal consequences if I do not take the field sobriety
no.
test? So once again, so far I'm okay.
Correct.
Now, there's another step that generally happens next, and I've seen it in most cases, but not all, the preliminary breath test. Mm-hmm. Explain that. What is the preliminary breath test?
So a lot of officers will have on scene a portable breath machine that they will ask you to blow into. And again, you do not have to do that because they're asking you to, they're not ordering you to.
Does that count as, everybody knows about the 0.08, mm-hmm. they hear about that on the TV news stories, mm-hmm. Machines at the jail. Does the PBT come in as evidence?
So the number itself will not come in, but it will come in as to whether you were satisfactory or unsatisfactory, meaning over an 0.08 or under an 0.08, because that's going to help the officer develop probable cause for your arrest. So that information will come in, but not the number itself.
Right. So it's kind of it's another building tool.
Exactly right.
To get
for the officer
for
to
conviction.
Build his or her case against you, yes.
Do I have to take, are there any adverse legal consequences if I do not take the PBT?
Not criminally speaking, no. But as far as civil liability, there's, unfortunately with DUIs, you have two things to worry about. You have the criminal side and you have the civil side. The civil side deals with the DMV. And so the Department of Motor Vehicles has all kinds of rules that they, impose upon people when a DUI is involved. And one of those rules is the PBT. If you refuse the PBT, your license will be suspended for 1 year.
And what is it if you comply with it, but get convicted of a DUI?
Convicted.
What's the revocation time frame for that?
For a first offense, typically 185 days.
And you can have a breath interlock device.
That will enable you to drive so long as you put that in your car, yes.
Which means you have a machine you blow into for 6 months or the 185 days.
It's not cheap either. It's about $12 a day, I think, is what it comes to.
Yeah, so 10 to 12 is what I tell my clients.
Looking at $350, $400 a month for that.
But you can drive.
Exactly.
And there's no good public transportation in this town.
It's true.
I mean, for the most part. So, you recommend that somebody takes the PBT?
If you don't want to lose your license for a year, because that's going to happen, if you do not blow into it, yes, I would recommend blowing into the PBT.
And what about you get to the jail if you don't take it there?
So now when you get down to the jail, at this point in time, you must submit to some kind of evidentiary testing.
And that's where I'm kind of skipping along here, but mm-hmm. you have to submit.
You do.
Because in Nevada, you can do a forced draw.
That's right.
So you better play ball at this stage.
And I was, I come from Ohio where I went to law school.
Yeah.
We didn't have that rule back there. I was shocked to learn that they could strap you down and take your blood without your consent out here.
Welcome to Nevada, boy.
Yes.
We got cowboys out here. Yeah, California's the same thing.
In fact, I didn't believe it at first. I was like, there's no way that could be true. I looked it up, sure enough, it's true.
Because let's say you don't take the blood or breath test mm-hmm. in Ohio or California, mm-hmm. they make you lose your license for a year. Mm-hmm. But what happened to the DUI conviction? They had trouble, right?
Yes, exactly right.
There's
yes.
big trouble for that.
Yes.
Especially if you're just speeding mm-hmm. or your driving is just, in a sense, I guess, normal traffic violations. Mm-hmm. If you're swerving all over the road.
That's a little bit different.
Yeah you can still lose.
Yes.
But out here, they'll strap you down.
Yeah, exactly right. I couldn't believe it when I first heard it, but they will. So they will typically, they will offer you the breathalyzer first. If
right.
you refuse that, then they'll say, hey, would you submit to a blood draw? If you say no to that, then the officer is required to get a search warrant from a judge. The judge will approve it if the judge feels that there was probable cause for the arrest, and then they will strap you down and they'll take your blood.
So jump on that train. So you're taking the test.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so back to the scene. FSTs, meaning field sobriety test, a preliminary breath test. You fail, they just hook you up right there?
They're going to arrest you right there for DUI, yes.
Take you down to the jail. What's the first step that happens at the jail?
So they're going to take you down to the jail. They're going to take you in. They're going to have you do the breath or the blood test. And the reason that they want to get that done quickly is they have a two-hour window where they get a presumption. And I'm not going to get into too many details, but there's a two-hour window that is very beneficial for the prosecuting agency to have your blood or your breath taken from when you were last driving your car. So it's not like they're going to drive you around for 3 hours, because they are kind of in a time crunch to get that blood draw or that breath within 2 hours of when you were last driving.
Got it. So they get the blood test within 2 hours, mm-hmm. or the breath test. Do you get let out of the jail? What happens next?
So you will be released.
And you're 0.08 or above, let's presume.
Okay, so let's say they charge you with a DUI and they arrest you. They're going to book you. They're going to fingerprint you, take your picture, all the stuff that they do. They're going to wait for you to sober up, basically. And once you prove that you are sober enough, you can either be released on some kind of administrative OR, or they will allow you to post bail and be released that way.
And posting bond, once again, costs people money. Therefore, that's why we always advocate, don't drink and drive.
It's a pretty easy thing to say, don't drink and drive, yes, but it is surprising how many people still do it.
Oh, I get it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's people get buzzed, they're feeling good, they think they're okay.
You know what I like about DUIs, and we've talked about this before, is whether you're a prosecuting attorney or a defense attorney, most people that commit DUIs are not trying to do any harm to anyone. They just want to get home. They want to get their car home, they want to have it for when they go to work the next day, and they just think, I'm going to roll the dice, I should be okay.
Right.
So they're not really trying to jam anybody up, but next thing you know, you're swerving in your lane, you're getting pulled over, and now it's going to cost you thousands of dollars in fees, thousands of dollars in potentially, you know, getting a bail, $1,000 to an attorney, all kinds of classes. I mean, it is just a bevy of information that you're going to have to deal with when you get arrested for a DUI.
Well, and that's a perfect segue into the penalties. So why don't we discuss the different types of DUI penalties?
Most DUIs are misdemeanors, meaning you get pulled over for some kind of traffic infraction or a very minor kind of fender bender. And so long as no one gets hurt, you're going to get a misdemeanor, and so long as you don't have any priors for doing it.
So the first offense is different than the second?
It is. So the penalties are going to be a little bit different. They're both misdemeanors. First and second offenses are both misdemeanors.
What's the time frame in Nevada?
7 years. So they're going to use a 7-year window to determine whether it's going to be a first offense or a second offense. So if you have a DUI from 85 and you pick up one tomorrow, it's going to be a first offense. They're not going to use that long of a gap. It's a 7-year window.
And what's the range of punishments?
Okay, so all misdemeanors are punishable by up to 6 months in jail. Typically, for your first offense on a DUI, jail time is not at the forefront of your mind. At least it should not be. What you want to try and worry about is, how can I get this DUI off my record? And so the attorney that you hire is going to be able to look at that report and determine, you know, whether that's going to happen or not. And of course, they need some cooperation from the state or the prosecuting agency. But you want to try and keep a DUI off your record if you can, because you don't want those to start adding up over time. And it will limit the amount of time that your license is suspended through the DMV.
So what classes do you have to take for a first offense, and what do you have to pay for a fine?
So the mandatory fine, minimum fine, $685. Depending on the jurisdiction, they vary a little bit. But statutorily, you must complete two classes, a DUI school and a victim impact panel. Many judges nowadays are adding a third class, which is called the Coroner's DUI program. And most judges require that you stay out of trouble while the case is open. So what would typically happen is they will give you 90 days in jail. It's all suspended. You don't do one day of that, so long as you comply with the court's orders. The court's going to order you to pay the fine, do those three classes, and stay out of trouble. If you do those things, the case is going to close. If you agree to do those things and then do not, the court is going to impose that 90 days that they have suspended hanging over your head.
Excellent. We're going to take a break for before we go back into the punishments. We're talking about Paul Pata. For the people.
Hi folks, Paul Pata for the people with another helpful tip. If you've been involved in a car accident or you've been injured as a result of some type of incident, it's extremely important that you go to a doctor immediately, regardless of whether you think you're seriously injured or not. Very important to make sure you document what's occurring at the time it's occurring, so that if you do bring a claim later, we have good documentation to be able to make a strong, forceful case for you. Always, always, always document your injuries and your experiences and what's going on by going to a doctor immediately after any type of personal injury event. This is Paul Pata for the people with another helpful tip.
Hello, Tony Abitangelo at the Red Chimp Studios for the Paul Pata podcast. Dan Gilliam, running for District Court Judge 23. We're talking about DUIs. Where we just left off, Dan, is DUI penalties. Mm-hmm. We talked about a first offense within 7 years. What's a second offense DUI conviction and 7 years?
So it's still going to be a misdemeanor, fortunately, so you don't have to worry about that, which means it's still maximum punishment is 6 months in county jail. However, there are a little bit differences. The fines go up The requirement for classes go up. Other requirements kick in. You have to get an evaluation to see if you have some kind of alcohol problem. Additionally, jail time goes up. And so you don't worry about too much jail time on the first offense if you don't have any aggravating factors. But on a second offense, there's a mandatory 10 days in jail. And so you will either do those 10 days or your attorney will figure out a way to try and keep those 10 days from having to be served.
Or, for example, he said you have to do the jail time. Mm-hmm. Some judges let you do it on the weekends.
Sure, yes.
Some would say too bad, too
exactly
sad.
Right.
You're doing a straight shot.
That's right. So your attorney will be able to look at the file to talk to the prosecuting attorney about, look, what can we do to obviate these 10 days? And there are ways that we can do that.
And one of the things that you talked about earlier ties into that, being cooperative or uncooperative.
Yes, that will be helpful. Yes, tremendously so. If when it comes down to that conversation that the attorney has with the prosecutor, for sure.
Right. Now, what happens if you have three DUIs within 7 years?
Okay, so there's a couple of different ways to get a DUI felony, and one of them is to have two priors on your record within a 7 year window. And so if you get pulled over and you get arrested for a DUI and it's your third offense within 7 years, they're going to enhance that to a felony, and now it gets very, very serious because it is not probationable. If you are found guilty of that at trial, you are going to prison.
1 year to 6 years.
1 year,
mandatory
6 year,
1 year.
Yes.
Also lose your license for 3 years,
that's
right?
Exactly right, yes.
So once again, more enhanced penalties. Because you mentioned earlier 185 days revocation of your license for a first. Mm-hmm. Third offense, 3 years.
Yes.
Then like you said, I think the victim impact panel. Mm-hmm. Is there any way to get out of that, even if you don't have a defense?
Yes, so the county has what's called the Serious Offenders Program, which is actually pretty helpful for people because it does two things. Number one, it addresses what is probably an issue that you have. If you have three DUIs in 7 years, there might be something going on that needs to be addressed on kind of a higher level.
Right? Once again, the classic, you didn't learn your lesson.
Exactly. And so, fortunately for our clients that are in that position, the state has not said, look, we just want to send you to prison. They have this SOP, Serious Offenders Program, where it is an extremely intensive three-year program. But if you can do it, it does two things for you. Number one, it keeps you out of prison, which is a big deal because you can still work and provide for your family. Second thing it does is it keeps a felony off of your record. And so you will ultimately plead to the felony, but they will kind of wait and see. And if you do this program, felony comes off the record. If you agree to the program and can't do it, off to prison you go, felony on your record.
Right. So you're not a felon.
Correct.
And
you're not going to prison.
And theoretically, you're sober. Right?
That's because the idea. That's the idea, is to try and keep you from driving in that state, yes.
Right, because as I've told a lot of clients, the law is very forgiving. They want you, they'll give you a break the first time. Mm-hmm. Like on a petty larceny. Stay out of trouble, did the class, dismissal.
Case dismissed.
If you get two, you get three, not the problem.
Yes, agreed.
And then we have the moderate offender program for first and second offenses.
Exactly right.
Which is for misdemeanors, because once again, I think the courts over the last 15, 20 years have come around and saying, look, let's solve the problem. Locking people up's not doing it. This guy's this person has a drinking problem. Mm-hmm. How do we address it? Mm-hmm. AA, counseling, et cetera.
All those things, yes.
Excellent.
A couple of things.
Go right ahead.
So we mentioned that one of the ways to get a felony DUI is if you have the priors, but there are a couple other ways.
Yes.
One is if you kill someone. And the third way would be is if you substantially injure someone, meaning a broken bone or something.
That's what I tell people, a broken bone.
I had a broken pinky case once.
And he healed.
Broken pinky was a felony, though.
Right.
Because my guy crashed into somebody and their pinky got broken.
And now you got big problems.
Now it's a felony, exactly.
This is the reasons why we don't want the drinking and driving. Mm-hmm. Because even somebody getting injured with, I would say, a minor injury. Because I tell people the substantial bodily harm statute is so broad and wide. Because mm-hmm. the second part of that says, the second part of the statute says prolonged pain. Is that what it says? Something like that?
So if you have some kind of note from a doctor that says this individual has had prolonged pain for the past 6 months, that's going to upgrade it to a felony.
Bam, done. Mm-hmm. Before we wrap up, what gave you the desire to run for district court judge?
So it's kind of been in my head for a long time now, and this was a very good time to do so. There were a lot of judges that are retiring. I didn't want to run against an incumbent, not because I didn't think that I could beat an incumbent. I just didn't like the idea of potentially taking someone's job. And so Department 24 made it known that the individual in that seat, which is Judge Crockett now, was not going to run for re-election. And so I thought, hey, here's my chance.
Excellent. I'm glad you came on the show.
Thanks,
Dan.
Thanks, Tony. I appreciate you
having me.
Thank you
for being here. We'd like to thank you for listening at Paul Pata Podcast, Red Chim Studios. Pay attention. Make sure you get out and vote. Have a great day. It's not a
about. It's not about.